Today, we're talking about this device, which is Absorbance 96, a new category of microplate reader. So if you've worked with microplate readers before, the first thing you'll notice about this device is that it's radically smaller than probably any other microplate reader you've ever seen before. Usually two questions arise at this point, and those are how and why. So how were we able to build this reader so compactly, and why are other microplate readers perhaps so large? And the answer to that question, or to both of those questions, lies in our design concept, which itself begins with four LEDs, which we see here at the back of the instrument. The light from these four LEDs, which are also used as signal lights for the system, is spread across a series of very, very finely drilled holes in the top of the instrument, which we refer to as light openings. This is achieved using polymer fibers, so sort of a fiber optic setup. So you can imagine that there are 96 very, very small optical filaments that run from the LEDs at the back of the device to each of those 96 openings in the top of the instrument. So this is what constitutes our optical unit, which is housed in the top of the device. So if I turn the device on its side, we can see here that it's sort of split into two parts. So in keeping with our concept in the top of having 96 light sources, we of course also need 96 detection units or detectors. And those are housed in the bottom part of the device. So basically this results in a system that has a total of 96 detection units, where a detection unit consists of an individual light source and an individual detector. So if we use the 96 well microplate, for example, this means that for each well on the 96 well plate, we have an individual light source on the top and an individual detector on the bottom. This is very different than the way that traditional microplate readers work, as they almost all work with some form of scanning mechanism. So you're probably familiar with this. You know, there's the microplate reader, and then some form of CD tray will come out of the reader. You put the plate on that tray, it disappears inside the instrument, and something happens, right? You hear some clunking noises. Basically, what's going on inside of that device is that that CD tray mechanism is being used to move the microplate back and forth underneath some form of scanning mechanism. Alternatively, the scanning mechanism itself can also move across the microplate. And basically, what happens when that scanning mechanism moves across the plate is each of the wells, in some cases eight channels, also in other cases a single channel, is used to sort of scan each well individually or a series of eight wells. As you can imagine, if you need to move the microplate back and forth one time, you automatically need double the area of the microplate. So in that description lies sort of the secret of how we were able to build this device so compactly, as we don't need to scan across the wells because we read everything in parallel. So we have 96 light sources, 96 detectors. And again, that's ultimately what allowed us to build the device so compactly. Of course, the size is one of the main results of this concept, but there are a few others. For example, the fact that we don't have any motors or moving parts or scanning mechanisms means that this device itself can be marketed as solid state. So what that means is kind of a familiar concept from hard drives, right? But this just refers to the fact that there are no moving parts inside of the instrument. So this also results in the device being maintenance free. So there aren't really any parts inside of the instrument that need to be, you know, replaced with time or service or anything like that. Another result of this sort of design concept is that we require very little power for the instrument. So because we don't need to power all of those motors, moving parts, scanning mechanisms, we can be powered just using a single USB cable that is, for example, attached to your laptop. So let's go ahead and attach the reader, and then I'll take you through the software. So we can go ahead and attach the instrument. When we plug it in, you'll see that all of the LEDs will light up in sequence. It's important that you see this when you attach the device. This shows you that it's made a successful connection to the software, but it also shows you that the self-test, which is performed when you plug it in, was also successful. So if we switch over to the software, something we really tried to achieve with the software was kind of taking the concept of the device, sort of, you know, small, minimalist, reductive, and applying that to the software. So to really just provide a nice user interface. So if we look here on the left-hand side, we have just kind of a classical user menu, a classical menu bar. Then we have our assay control bar, which basically just shows you where you are at any given step of the setup. And then we have the main window, which is where you're going to control all of the parameters for your assay. So we can get started with this. You can, for example, select a name, enter any name that you want for your assay. and then we get started with the workflow parameters. This begins with your wavelength. As I mentioned during the demo of the hardware, Absorbance 96 has four different LEDs. These LEDs allow you to select four different wavelengths, which you see here in the software. We also have the option to select a reference wavelength. A reference wavelength is basically a secondary wavelength, secondary to your primary wavelength, of course. And this is a wavelength at which we would measure and whose results would then be subtracted from those values measured at the primary wavelength. For the purposes of the demo, we won't use a reference. Then we have our method. Here you can select between endpoint or kinetic. So of course, endpoint is kind of saying we have a reaction, the reaction has already taken place, and we want to perform a measurement at the end of that reaction and see what happened. With the kinetic experiment, where we want to take several measurements over a certain time course, which you could then do here in the software by setting your interval and your duration. But we'll stick with endpoint for the purposes of the demo. We then can move on to our evaluation. We have no evaluation, we have a quantitative evaluation and a qualitative evaluation. No evaluation is kind of our version of read only, so no calculations are going to be performed if you select this. This is just if you want to read a bunch of samples, for example, export the data, and maybe do the analysis in Excel or whatever software you'd like to use. That being said, our software does offer a lot of analysis possibilities. So if we move over to quantitative, we see here that we could, for example, select a fitting method. This is what you could use if you wanted to, for example, plot a standard curve and calculate the concentration of an unknown. We also have qualitative analysis available in the software, and this is used to kind of answer more yes or no, positive or negative question, right? So that kind of qualitative response that you're looking for, is this in my sample or not? Not necessarily in what concentration. We'll stick with quantitative for the purposes of the demo. As I mentioned, we can then select a fitting method. We have various fitting methods available in the software. We could, for example, select a four-parameter analysis. We can then go on to our plate layout. So the plate layout in our software is designed very intuitively. It sort of works like a paint program, I guess you'd be familiar with from something like Microsoft Paint. Whatever you click is what you're gonna kind of draw or paint onto the microplate in the software. So if we wanted to find some standards, for example, we can click here on the standards, and then we basically just click and drag down the plate. If we wanted to define all of these in duplicate, we could do that. We don't have to click a bunch of times. We can just click here on duplication pattern, select a 2x1 duplication pattern, and then again, just click and drag. And as you see, they will all be defined in duplicate. You can then select units. You can select these from the drop-down menu, or you can just type them in. So I could also type in PPM here, for example, if that's the unit I want to use, press enter, and they're all filled out. I will enter some type of fictitious concentration here just so we get some results. But again, of course, you would be entering your real concentrations. We can then define some blanks, then a bunch of samples. Here you also have the option to add sample IDs. These can also be copied from an Excel file. So you could select using the copy and paste function on your keyboard, you can paste a series of sample names into this field. We then also have a dilution factor, which you can apply to your samples. We also have various controls available in the software. These controls are for various types of experiments. So some of them are more for ELISA, but in addition to the controls, we also have custom well types. So you can use custom well types to, for example, define your own type of control or just have another type of well that you want to run in addition to any other assay parameters. We then have our assay validation. Here you see smart validation. This is a feature from Byonoy. This basically just runs some checks on your assay and includes things like checking the percent CVs between your replicates to make sure that your pipetting is correct. But we'll see that at the end in the results section. You also have the option here to add a custom validation. So let's say we want to make sure that our blanks aren't too high. We can add a validation formula and say we want to make sure the value of the blanks are less than 0.2 OD. Press enter and that will be run automatically. So once we've defined our plate layout here and our other assay parameters, we can go here in the assay control bar to readout, and we'll be led step by step through the readout process. So if we go back to the reader here, you'll see that we have to perform an initialization. An initialization is essentially a reference measurement that's used to set the zero point of the device. So you're probably familiar with this from things like spectrophotometers, right? We always have to zero the instrument. That's an instrument that has only one channel, so we have to perform this type of zeroing as well, but we just have to do it 96 times as we have 96 individual detection units. So we can go ahead and press OK here in the software. You'll see the initialization is accompanied by a lighting of the respective LED. Now we're being prompted to insert the microplate, so we can go ahead and do that. Now we're ready to start the measurement. So we can press OK. You'll see here again that the LED will light up, and we already have our results. So that's one thing I didn't mention during the hardware demo is that, of course, because we don't need to scan back and forth across the microplate, we can read very rapidly. So everything's essentially read in parallel, meaning that we can read in very rapid times down to around 3 seconds for a 96-well plate. Then in the software here, we can see that we have a plate overview. We then have our plot view. So this is the standard curve that we plotted. You can also show the x-axis logarithmically, for example, and you can also show where your standards fall on where your samples fall, rather, on the standard curve. We then have our fitting properties, and then we have our assay validation. So again, you can see here that most of them pass successfully. We are getting a warning, in this case, because of our replicates. So again, we maybe made some pipetting errors here, and it's just warning us that we should maybe pay attention to that and go back and check. Maybe we forgot to dilute one of our standards. We also see that our custom validation was successful, so all of our blanks are less than 0.2 OD. We then have a tabular overview of our standards, our controls, and our samples, showing some statistical values like our mean values of any replicates and the percent CVs. This data could then be exported. You can export this as a PDF report or as a CSV file, for example, which could then be imported into Excel. One other option you have at this stage, like I said, if we look at some of our replicates and we're getting some warnings, we may have an outlier here. In this case, we can click on it and say, okay, standard number 3 is looking a bit odd. We can go back to setup, we can go to standard 3, and we can just clear standard 3. And we don't have to repeat the measurement or repeat the experiment, we can just go back to results. You'll see here that standard 3 has disappeared from the standard curve, and it has also been taken into account in other calculations. Okay. That's it for the overview of Absorbance 96 and the Absorbance 96 app. If you have any further questions, please feel free to reach out to us. We look forward to hearing from you. Thank you.